In this video, I go over session host load balancing with Windows Virtual Desktop. Hello, I'm Travis and this is Seraltos. In this video, I go over load balancing in Windows Virtual Desktop. Load balancing is the way requests are directed to a pool of resources. In this case, load balancing refers to how connections are distributed across the pool of session host computers in Windows Virtual Desktop. This video goes over the two methods of load balancing offered by Windows Virtual Desktop, BreadthFirst and DepthFirst. Before that, please take a second to subscribe. It makes Toby happy, and Toby's had a rough week. He could use some cheering up. Moving on, BreadthFirst load balancing is the default for newly created Windows Virtual Desktop host pools. This method distributes user connections across all the available hosts. When a new connection comes in, the connection is directed to the session host with the least number of active connections. With BreadthFirst, setting the max number of connections per host is optional. Here you can see how connections get distributed across the session host as users log in. You can also see how disconnected users are reconnected to existing sessions despite the number of connections on that computer. Disconnected sessions are also reconnected if the computer is set not to allow new connections. Up next is DepthFirst load balancing. DepthFirst maximizes connections to one session host before moving new connections to the next. If multiple servers are running and have connections, new connections will go to the server with the most connections first, up to the maximum number of connections for that host. For this to work, a maximum number of connections per session host must be set. The number of maximum connections can be different for different host pools, but will be the same for all VMs in a host pool. Here's an illustration. Let's say the max number of connections on a session host is 4, so I can keep this PowerPoint animation simple. One server will fill up first before moving on to the next. Like BreadthFirst, if a session gets disconnected, it will reconnect to the host. This prevents data loss due to orphan connections. DepthFirst has the potential to save money by only utilizing the servers needed. For example, those two servers on the right are not doing anything and could be deallocated to save some money. To realize any savings, though, there would need to be a mechanism to start shut down servers dynamically. The Microsoft Docs references a script that does that, but it's fairly complicated and requires a dedicated server to run on. I suspect we'll see a better solution for dynamically starting and stopping VMs in the near future. As mentioned previously, both DepthFirst and BreadthFirst will reconnect user sessions even if the session host is set not to allow new connections. Speaking of that, hosts can be set to disable new connections with the Allow New Sessions attribute on the session host. This will not log out existing connections, just prevent new ones. Also, load balancing only applies to pooled host pools. Personal host pools have a one-to-one mapping and don't require load balancing. One more thing, I noticed the Microsoft documentation indicates that BreadthFirst distributes connections to provide the best user experience. This, in my opinion, is not the right way to size a remote desktop environment. The host pool should be sized to accommodate the max number of users per host, whatever that number of users is. For example, if an organization has 100 potential users for a host pool, they could deploy 10 smaller hosts allowing 10 connections each in DepthFirst mode, or 4 large hosts that allow 25 connections each in BreadthFirst. From the user's perspective, the load balancing method should not matter. I guess what I'm saying is that if the max number of users allowed on a session host in a pool does not provide a good user experience, there is a problem with sizing or technology, not the load balancing method. Moving on to the demo, I'm going to walk through viewing the existing BreadthFirst configuration, configure DepthFirst, and disable new sessions.
Okay, buckle up everyone, it's demo time. So the first thing I'm going to do is log in, and I actually did that before I hit record. And the next thing I'm going to do is come up to these two variables. I'm just going to run them to set my host pool name and tenant name. So I'll just run those real quick. That just makes running future commands easier. Speaking of that, I'll have all these commands available on my website. I'll include the link below. The next thing I'm going to do is look at the current status of the host pool. And I do that with the get RDS host pool command. Oops. Here you can see it's set to BreadthFirst. and the maximum session limit is 999,999. So that would be for unlimited number of sessions. Next, I want to look at the session host. So I'm going to use the get RDS session host command. And if I just run this selection here, you can see it gives me details about both of my session hosts. I do want to see that in a different format though. All I want to see is the session host name, sessions, and allow new session setting. So I'm going to take that command and pipe it into a format table. There, that looks better. So I have two session hosts. Neither of them have sessions, and they are both allowing new sessions. With this set to BreadthFirst, I'm going to log into a couple remote desktop sessions, and we'll see what happens. I'm now signed on to two remote desktop sessions. Let's see what this looks like now. Here it is. The number of sessions is one each. That's because BreadthFirst distributes the connections across all available session hosts. So I have two logged in, one each. Next, I'm going to use the set RDS session host command to set the session host that ends in a -1 to not allow any new sessions. This will disable any new sessions. This is a good option if you want to take servers out of service, but you don't want to kill any existing connections. You can disable new connections. People will bleed off as they log out, and then once everybody's logged out, you can do maintenance on it or whatever needs to be done. There it is, and you can see allow new sessions is now set to false. Let's just look at that grid again. There it is. So now you can see new sessions are set to false. So what happens now if I log in a couple more times? I'm now logged into a total of 4, so let's run this command again. And here you can see, although it's BreadthFirst, the first session host took the additional 2 for a total of 3, while the other one just stayed at 1. It didn't log off the session that was in there, but it's not taking any more. So that's exactly what we would have expected. So I'm going to set this to true, so it allows new connections, and we're going to move on. Next, I'm going to run get RDS host pool again and just see where we're at here. Okay, we're still set to BreadthFirst with 999,000 connections. The next command, the set RDS host pool, is going to set the host pool to DepthFirst with a maximum session limit of 2. 2 is pretty small. These are small VMs, but more than anything, I just want to demonstrate without having to log into a bunch. I'm going to run this command. Now my session host pool is set to DepthFirst with a maximum of 2 connections. I'm going to log into 2 remote desktop sessions, and let's take a look at how those get distributed now that we're in DepthFirst mode. All right, I'm now logged in twice. Let's see what this grid looks like. Unlike BreadthFirst that distributes the sessions between the session hosts, DepthFirst will assign sessions to one session host until the maximum number of connections is met, in this case 2, and then starts with the next. Next, I'm going to log in a couple more times so we can see the -1 session host fill up. Now I'm logged into 4. Let's take a look at that command again. Okay, so as you'd expect, it directed the next 2 sessions to a -1 session host. But what happens if we try a 5th now that we have max connections set to 2 each, and there's only 2, so that's 4 total connections. I'm going to just try to log in to the 5th. Okay, so that threw an error. I can try reconnecting just to make sure, but I think we're going to see that error again. It just gave me the error again. So once the maximum number of connections for the host pool is met, nobody can log in, which is exactly what I guess you'd expect with setting the max sessions. Okay, so we went over the default settings of BreadthFirst. We saw that work. We disabled new sessions on one of the 2 session hosts and saw how that behaves with BreadthFirst. We switched to DepthFirst and saw how that distributes connections. And then we tried to go over the maximum number and saw that that failed. The only thing left to do is I want to change this back to BreadthFirst. So if I come here, I can run this command. This is the set RDS host pool command, and we're changing it to BreadthFirst load balancer. And you can see that did it, but there is a problem still. It's set to BreadthFirst, but you can see that the max session limit is 2. So you don't need to specify a max session limit with BreadthFirst, but it will just keep that old setting. So I'm going to set the max connections to 999,000. Now it's set, let's run the get RDS host pool command again. And here you can see it's set to BreadthFirst with 999,000. So that puts it back the way it was when we started. That does it for the demo.
That's it for the video. You can find the commands I used on my blog, link below. I hope you found this helpful. Please take a second to subscribe and click the bell icon for new content. Thanks for watching.